now in our sixth year, this is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Hey everybody, this is The Ramble. I'm Alex Bennett. We'll be here until midnight tonight on the East Coast of the United States and all around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, out to California we go in the lovely vocalizing of Larry Bubbles Brown. Hello, Larry.
Hey, Alex. Great to be back. from our crumbling city.
Yeah, our crumbling careers. And
those crumbled a long time ago.
Well, you know, actually, if you think about it, you've had a pretty good career. You know? You're one of the few comics I know that is still, when there is not a pandemic going on, is still, you know, working. You know,
you wonder how long can you do this? I guess we talked about the guy who was 107 in SAG, so maybe you can't do it till you drop.
But he hasn't made a movie in years. Okay. Yeah.
Someone that's really like Clint Eastwood's 90 and he's very active.
Yeah, he is. He's still directing films.
That's incredible. Did you ever interview him?
Never.
Wow.
You know, I mean, I found that when I finally started doing a lot of, movie stars, I don't know, did I have a lot of movie stars in the San Francisco show? I don't know.
You had Kim Novak.
Yeah, we had Kim.
She was interesting. She seemed mysterious.
Well, she always had, you know. Truth be known, I mean, she was like my heartthrob. When I was a kid, Kim Novak, when she did that dance with William Holden in Picnic, I think it was the first time I felt a wet spot in my pants. Okay? I mean, really. So I was really hot for Kim Novak. But she wasn't a very good actress. If you go back and watch her, she was really pretty bad. You know? I mean, she was not Hitchcock's favorite. He used her in one picture, which was Vertigo, which is one of his most famous pictures, and so therefore she gained a lot of fame off of that. But he didn't want her in the film. He wanted Vera Miles to play that part, who was his favorite actress at the time. And Vera Miles wasn't available because she was pregnant and having a baby. So he went with his second choice, which was Kim Novak, who, you know, she could act, kind of. The acting job in that film wasn't that deep. She basically had to be a kind of just this image of this woman. You know the movie, Vertigo.
They shot around her.
They shot around her, yeah. One of Jimmy Stewart's best films, oddly enough. And one of only four he made for Alfred Hitchcock. Can you name the other three?
Oh, wow. That's a good trivia question. Let's see. Rear Window?
That's right.
With Doris Day.
Mm-hmm. Man Who Knew Too Much?
The Man Who Knew Too Much. Oh, and...
I don't think you're going to get the next one.
I won't get the next one.
Rope.
Oh, he was in that? Yeah. I've never seen that.
Yeah, Rope is the film Hitchcock made that was one traveling shot for the whole film. One camera moving.
I got to see that.
Yeah. And you say, well, how did he change reels in the camera? And in those days, they didn't have the kind of technology they have today where they can do a one-shot movie. They did it with, like, I don't know, what was that movie with Michael Keaton, where he was a former action star. I can't remember the name of it now. But there are a couple other films, 1917 they did, which was one traveling shot throughout the film. But it was all done using technology, okay, so that it seemed that that's what was happening. But, you know, with Hitchcock, you get, I think it was 20 minutes of film in a camera, or 15 minutes on a reel. And so he would then, when the reels were going to run out, he would, like, move the camera into somebody's back and then move around them when he came back.
Okay.
See? And then he could do the cut there.
Yeah.
And that's how he did. And the whole film was done as one traveling shot. And
pretty ingenious.
Yeah, and that was the first one that Stewart ever did with Hitchcock. So, yeah.
So he didn't like Kim.
Well, he didn't feel she was very good, you know. I mean, the part, when he conceived of it, as being, what's her name? Vera Miles, who later went on to be the sister of Janet Leigh in Psycho. Anybody doesn't remember Vera Miles. And Vera Miles, I think, was the lead in that Henry Fonda one, The Wrong Man. I think she played his... I'm not sure. I may be wrong. Anyway, I don't know. I'm losing my mind. I'm getting old. I'm forgetting stuff.
That would be very intense if a director and a big star, the director just didn't think the guy had it and had to do a huge movie with him.
Yeah. Yeah.
I read that happened with Fahrenheit 451. It was the, who was the French director?
Truffaut
and Oscar Werner, just, they hated each other, and at one point in the middle of film, Oscar Werner cut his hair just to fuck with the continuity.
Oh, man.
So I can imagine that was a fun set. So
he really hated him, huh?
Yeah, they just. I think he thought he wasn't right for the first day. This is the wrong guy for the part. And
why didn't he just get rid of him?
I guess he was contracted or something. He couldn't, and it sounded like an interesting story. That and the other story I read about was. Okay, this is, you know, you're getting to see now. You can't remember names. The director of. Of Strangelove.
Kubrick. Yeah.
The last film he did was Eyes Wide Shut, which was, that took 1,000 days to shoot, 3 years. And they said people were having breakdowns and they just quit. And
actually, what was happening is that during the breaks in the film, Cruise would come back to the United States, make a whole movie, and then go back and work some more on that film. Really? That's how much time... I mean, it took the longest amount of time. And I think, I don't know, that may be because Kubrick was older, maybe he was dying or something.
And I think he'd always done a zillion takes and things like that, but I think he was just kind of losing his mind at the end, probably, and...
Yeah, well, you know what made, oddly enough, made Steven Spielberg's career? Spielberg, when he started out, was that kind of director who would do endless takes to get the right one he wanted, right? And eventually he got a bad reputation in Hollywood because, number one, his films weren't doing that well. 1941 was a big failure. And they were costing too much because he did so many takes when he was doing a movie. Well, all of a sudden, Lucas comes to him with this film he is going to do called Indiana Jones. And he asks Spielberg, would he like to do it? And Spielberg says, yes. He says, I'll let you do it under only one condition, and that's that you don't take too many takes on each scene, because you're known for that, and I don't have that kind of budget. Okay, it's an expensive enough picture as it is. And so what he did was he forced himself to try and get everything on the first take. And he learned that you need to do 20 takes on a scene, because when you would do 20 takes on a scene, you'd probably come back and use the final take, which was just like the first take you originally did.
Right.
You know, so he got used to the idea of get it on as few takes as is humanly possible. And that film was a huge success for him. and maybe one of the most perfect films ever made. If I want to show a film student how to make a perfect movie, I'll show them, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark. And that taught him a lesson, and from then on, he was a major success in Hollywood and very bankable. But you're not bankable when you sit there and go, another take, another take, another take. And I'm sure Kubrick probably, if we went back and took the first takes of everything that he did, you know, probably be a pretty good movie, you know. I think it's just an insecurity on the part of a director that he does that many takes.
It's got to be. I think Kubrick, Nicholson in the Shining had to do like 57 takes in that one scene where he was Johnny, I think. Yeah.
You know, and so, you know, it's just directors learn that when as they get more confidence. But it's strange that that Kubrick should have had the confidence that he wouldn't have to do take after take after take after take. He'd go, hey, I'm Stanley Kubrick, you know. But apparently not. That was his way of making films. You know the other way he made films? He owned all his own equipment. That's one of the reasons they took so long to make. He owned all his own equipment, so he didn't have to go out and rent equipment. All right? So he could take forever, and he isn't paying for those cameras. He owns them already. And all the lights and everything. He owned everything. So therefore, he had the luxury of being able to take 3 years to make a movie. Just the movie companies weren't happy with it because it kept costing them money. Yeah. So,
well, he would have been a great interview for you.
You know, I imagine he would have been a difficult interview. I imagine that interviewing him would have been very difficult.
Probably reclusive.
Yeah, you know, and not cooperative. And probably for that reason, that's why I probably would never have been able to do an interview with him. In fact, I don't know of an existing interview with Stanley Kubrick.
Well, let's see if we can find one.
Yeah, I don't think if anybody out there knows of one, let me know, you know. But I don't even think when they do like the making of The Shining, you know, and promotional things like that, that he ever appeared in those things.
I saw a good documentary a couple of years ago about this English guy, an assistant that worked with Kubrick for years and talked about working with him.
Yeah.
That was cool.
And what did they say?
He lauded him, but it was very difficult to work with him.
Well, the guy obviously was a perfectionist, you know. And his films got more and more complicated to make. In the early days, he was doing black and white 90-minute films that were very effective films, but he didn't have the money to do endless amounts of takes, so they were very sparse. But, you know, I mean, it's that's the way it is. And it's he was a great director, but I bet he was insecure as hell because he wouldn't have done that many takes if he wasn't insecure.
Yeah, and obviously a sense of humor with Dr. Strangelove. So.
Yes, although that sense of humor came from Terry Southern, who wrote the screenplay.
You know. And Peter Sellers.
And Peter Sellers, who did an amazing piece of work there by playing three different people.
How did that not get an Oscar?
Well, you know, people never get Oscars for the films they should have, and they
right.
get the... I remember Elizabeth Taylor couldn't get an Oscar to save her life. She did all kinds of great films, Cat in a Hot Tin Roof, and so on and so forth. Ultimately, what did she win the Academy Award for? Do you remember?
No.
Butterfield 8. What? Yeah. A film that she hardly gets remembered for. You know, but if she played a prostitute in it or something, they gave her the Academy Award for that. And a lot of people said it was they just gave her the Academy Award because they felt guilty about not giving it to her the year before.
I think a lot of them go that, well, it's probably her turn now. So.
I mean, I don't think Meryl Streep could win another Academy Award. I think people are so sick of her being nominated, they're just not about... She's won the award on several occasions, and that's it, you know?
Yeah.
Goodbye. You know, and don't even nominate her. Leave room for other people. You know, I we'll go a little bit over here, but you know what really gets me about the nominations this year for Best Film? The bar has really been lowered.
They've got too many films.
The problem is that it isn't that they have too many films. Is that they didn't have that many films that were made to be shown in a theater. Okay? Most of the films that are being nominated for the Academy Award, you can see right now on Netflix or Hulu or Amazon. Basically, that's where the awards are coming from this year. So you don't have, like, major films being released right now. They're very careful to not do that. I think Warner Brothers is releasing some of their tentpole pictures on HBO Max, but that's about it. So, I mean, the films, for instance, we watched a film the other night, Minari, which is nominated for nominated for an Academy Award. I think so. But it is being nominated in the SAG Awards. And we watched it, and it's a nice little film, but who cares? You know? I mean, it just doesn't make it. So, I mean, this year is not a great year for the Academy Awards because they don't really have any theatrical pictures.
Right.
You know? They've been sitting around waiting to release the latest James Bond movie forever.
Jesus.
I mean, it's been going on for fucking ever. I think it was supposed to be released a year ago December. A year ago in March? About this time of year. And they canceled it because of the coronavirus. They said, we're moving it to November. They moved it to November. They canceled it. Now we're moving it to April. I mean, and now this, who knows when it's going to come out? And I said, you know, and the problem is Warner Brothers at least can release these things to HBO Max. And because they own HBO Max, or the parent company owns HBO Max, they can at least maximize their profits by running it on HBO Max. Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, who released that movie, the Bond movie, doesn't really have an outlet for it. And so they don't have anywhere to monetize it. And so they're just not releasing it. And I'm thinking about, what's his name going to play another Bond? Whatever his name is, I forget his name.
Daniel Craig.
Is he going to play another Bond? No, he's not going to be able to play another Bond. He's going to be too old by the time this one gets released. So, you know, be James Bond chasing the bad guy in a wheelchair.
A walker.
Yeah, you know.
The wheelchair would have all the fancy gadgets.
Oh yeah, like it would have all the gadgets on it. There's no question about it, you know. Have the oil slick thing and the smoke in the back.
That was hilarious.
If I had enough money, I'd do a little preview of the new Bond film from a wheelchair.
Oh, that'd be a great sketch, yeah.
Yeah. You'd get Raymond Burr to star as James Bond.
Right.
You know, it's Ironsides. Remember that? A whole series about a detective, a police detective in a wheelchair.
Uh-huh.
Well, I got news for you. To begin with, if he wound up in a wheelchair, they'd give him a pension and send him on his way. You know?
Exactly.
But no, he was such a good cop, we had to keep him going. And I wondered how Raymond Burr, who kept gaining weight anyway, liked doing his roles from a wheelchair in which he was only more sedentary. You know?
That didn't do his weight any good.
Yeah. And of course, the gayest actor in Hollywood.
A long career.
A long career. Oh, absolutely. You remember, what Hitchcock picture was he the bad guy in?
I know this. Can't think of it.
Rear Window.
Okay.
That's the guy that James Stewart thinks killed his wife. It turns out
right,
he did.
Yeah,
and then he,
yeah.
I don't want to spoil it in case you've never seen it, folks. So we won't. Hey, listen, I think we've kind of run out of time here. I think it's been great talking to you once again, Larry Bubbles Brown.
And you came up with a great sketch, the James Bond in the wheelchair.
Yeah, yeah. As soon as we get a TV show, which will never happen, we'll do that sketch on it.
We will.
Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, Larry Bubbles Brown. See you next week, Larry.
See you, Alex.
Now in our sixth year, this is GabNet, the Great American Broadcast Network. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Hey, everybody. Larry Bubbles Brown. We love Larry. Of course we love Larry. Everybody loves Larry. Anyway, let me see here. What? Anything I got to talk to you about? Watched a little bit of the trial again today. I saw more evidence mounting up against this guy, and it's going to be kind of interesting. What's going to happen when the defense gets up, which will be in about midway in next week? Lost a couple, three people, one of which you probably, if I say the name, you don't know who I'm talking about. All right, but let me give it a try here. Gee, I have a little tear in my eye there. What is that? Oh, see that shininess? See, that's what happens when I get a. I have to get a camera with less definition, because I'm not getting any prettier by the day. Okay. Anyway, we lost Prince Philip. He's gone. And, you know, I mean, we could sit around and get really sobby about it, but there's nothing to be sobby about. The guy lived to be 99. And that, of course, kept Queen Elizabeth alive. I think she's going to go soon, just simply because usually when you have people who have been married that long together, they're so used to living out their lives together that when one dies or the other one follows a short time behind. So, and then the question is going to become, who becomes king? Or, yeah, king, because it would be a male heir this time. Will Charles say, yes, mom finally died, I'm going to take the job, okay, and hold it for however short amount of time that he could hold on to it? Or is he just going to say, okay, William, go ahead, I don't need it, and you become, you're young, and you'll have a nice long reign, and let you become the king. So we'll have to wait and see what happens. The other question is, what's going to happen with Harry? Because Grandpa died, all right? So Grandpa died, and is he going to go to the funeral? I think he probably will. There's a question as to whether Meghan will follow him on it. She could use as her excuse, well, I'm pregnant and I really, my doctors have said I shouldn't travel. Okay? And she, you know, I don't know that she necessarily has to go, because it's not like she's been, it's been her father-in-law for more than a couple of years, you know? So So I don't know if she's going to go, but we'll wait and see. Anyway, and then who else did we lose? Well, we lost DM. See, this shows how much I know my rap stuff. DMZ, I guess. Is that? Do I have it right? I don't think it's DMX. I think it's DMZ. I mean, hold on a second. Let me see here. Let me look up Drudge. It's got to be on the Drudge website. You know, here we go. Drudge Report. Philip is dead at Windsor Castle. And, rapper DMX. DMX. I said DMC. That's why the kids don't watch this show, okay? DMX. Quite frankly, if you played me, this is how far away from the mainstream I've become. if you asked me to name one song by DMX, I couldn't tell you, okay? But I hear people like them, and it's a big, important death. So there's one other death, this is a death that one which you probably don't know about, and it doesn't mean much to you, but it means a bit to me. Years ago, I had a friend, one of the first people I ever, in fact, the first person I ever had on my show in New York City when I did a Saturday night interview show was Michael O'Donoghue. And you may remember the name. He was Mr. Mike over at Saturday Night Live, and he became one of the early writers on SNL. And he had been working at the National Lampoon. And I had known about his work for the longest time when I was living in Chicago. Said, I got to have this guy on my show. So I found him and booked him. And then I also wanted to have on Paul Krasner. So they were the first two guests I ever had on my show here in New York when I was on WMCA. That was a Saturday night show that I did, where I took over for Barry Gray on Saturday nights and did a show similar to his. And so those were the first two guests I ever had on. Well, when he went over to Saturday Night Live, Michael had a girlfriend who later became his wife. And he brought her along to SNL, and she became one of the first female writers on the show. And her name was Ann Beats. And come to find out, she died about 2 days ago at the age of 75, I think. Ann Beats. Ann Beats also went on to do a show that Sarah Jessica Parker starred in about young teenage kids. What was it called? I'm trying to remember the name of it now. But anyway, she went on, did a lot of other writing and so on, but Michael died. I remember when he died. It was amazing because, you know, when you're young, you don't expect people who are about the same age you are to suddenly drop dead, and Michael dropped dead. He had a heart attack, and Anne was his widow. But she was one of the great early female writers. I think if you were to ask people like Tina Fey or any of Amy Poehler or any of the people that are doing comedy today and writing it today, they will venerate Ann Beats and what she contributed to the world. She also wrote, I think, a book called Titters about female comedy. But anyway, she's gone. So we lost. They say they go in threes, and for me they went in threes, but maybe for you, you're still waiting for the other shoe to drop because Ann Beats doesn't mean much to you. But DMX and Prince Philip do, and they're gone, and, you know, soon it will be my turn, okay? Who knows when? I only hope I can live to be as long as Prince Philip, and then when I go, not really know that I'm gone, okay? Just get me to a point where I'm not aware of anything around me, and then let me die. I think that's the way I would like to die. Anyway, you know, it could be any of you out there. You could be somebody in your 30s or 40s who's listening, watching the show right now. Tomorrow you get run over by a car, so... Hey, you know, we all drop dead one way or another. Anyway, I think I better go to the people who want to be on the citizen panel, of which there are only three waiting. This doesn't give me much desire to continue doing what I do here when I suddenly go to the thing and there are only three other people. So. But there they are. There's Charlie Wallace. There's Alan. And there is Trucker Steve, ladies and gentlemen, and his sidekick Rocky, who is not there right now. Or is Rocky around? Or is Rocky just he's upstairs. Is it my estimation that when Rocky isn't traveling with you in the truck, he doesn't want to be anywhere near you because he's seen you too much?
It would be too long.
Huh?
2 weeks. He's had enough.
Yeah, he's had enough of you. Yeah. Does he like actually going on the truck?
Yeah.
I mean, I know you like it because it's company, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's company, which is good. But he'd be just as happy staying home, right? He doesn't go. Probably. He doesn't go. Oh my God, we're going on another trip.
But I like bringing
again.
Him with me.
What?
I like bringing him with me.
Yeah, yeah. It's another breathing soul in the cab of that truck, right? And here's Jeff. Hello, Jeff. Show us your full face, will you? Just kind of.
Oh, sorry.
Adjust the camera.
How's that?
Yeah.
That's the face today.
Yeah. Everybody tends to sometimes come on here and look like they're wearing their screen as their camera as a mask, you know. Anyway, Charlie Wallace, hello to you. What's new? How about giving us the death toll?
Oh, 931 Americans passed from COVID today.
Yeah.
But that put us over 31 million cases today.
31?
I mean, that's the total of past the 31 million mark.
Yeah, but so far as...
deaths, it's 560,996.
God, it just keeps going, doesn't it?
Going up.
Doesn't it? Mm. Well, the...
But the numbers are below 1,000, so that's good.
Yeah, for... the last couple of days, yeah.
Yeah, but we might expect that to jump up, you know. To begin with, they have bad news, folks. The Johnson & Johnson is not going to be shipped much next week, mainly because they had all those problems with production on it. And also, people, you know, I think people are afraid of Johnson & Johnson, and they shouldn't be, really.
Yeah.
You know why they're not shipping it?
Why is that, Alan?
Well, I read in the news that they make the AstraZeneca in the same plant, and the two of them got mixed up before they noticed it before they actually bottled it.
Wait a minute. Hold on a second. How do you accidentally take one drug and put it in the bottles for another drug? And
I have no idea. They're both clear liquids. Who knows?
And then you're asking the Americans out there who want this thing to have great confidence in the Johnson & Johnson.
Absolutely.
Which seems like it's slowly turning into a clusterfuck.
Oh, yeah.
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 Well, what the hell? Yeah.
I don't want to say anything bad about Johnson & Johnson. But
go ahead.
They used to be a customer of mine. So.
What about
I own stock in the company?
You know, they had some issues over the years. They had a lot of different products.
I know, because I had a Band-Aid I put on once, and then I tried to get it off, and it stuck too much to my skin.
Yeah.
And it hurt like hell to take it off.
So. I hate when that happens.
I hate it. Yeah, that happens to me a lot.
Yeah, that damn
pulls the skin off with it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then they had baby powder. Remember that with asbestos? They're the ones with asbestos in it. And these are the guys we're trusting with our COVID, huh?
They found that in the heart valves too, asbestos.
Kidding. No,
I hope you're kidding.
Yeah.
Well, you know, Rachel, who's on TV on MSNBC.
Oh, Rachel Maddow.
Yeah, she took a injection from Johnson & Johnson today.
Really? Well.
And she didn't die.
It's been, well, not yet.
Not yet.
Maybe she's going to grow a Johnson.
Well, she'd like to. No, not nice to say.
I'm not going to say that.
I don't know. I've watched Rachel, and I know you people love her. But I don't know why. I just don't see what's so wonderful about Rachel Maddow. Maybe you can tell us, Charlie. You seem like you're a fan.
Hey, I don't watch MSN.
Oh, okay.
I can't. She just meanders on so long, it takes him like a half an hour to get to the point. I couldn't watch her anymore.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Then I guess I'm not wrong in my assessment that I can't see what anybody sees in her.
I don't like her either.
Yeah.
Is Marjorie lighter?
Like, I like her.
Marjorie's not up that late.
No, she's,
you know.
Pam watches it every night. Yeah. She loves it. But she falls asleep.
She falls asleep to her. So apparently, even a Rachel Maddow fan doesn't really get with the program.
Yeah.
What were you saying, John?
She meanders sometime, but she's a good storyteller and she does her homework, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I don't know if she still does it, but she writes everything she says.
Yeah,
she's a good writer.
I read,
she doesn't know how to ad lib.
I read the book about that she wrote about Agnew, and it was great.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I didn't know how crooked that guy was. You know, I grew up in that time. I know he got kicked out of being vice president, but he was so fucking crooked. He was taking payoffs in the White House, you know, mm-hmm. from when he was governor of Maryland, and they were scared that he was going to become president, so they delayed on impeaching Nixon because they knew if they impeached Nixon and he was still vice president, he'd have become president.
Yeah.
And that would have been fucking horrendous.
Well, that was an interesting situation anyway, because when Agnew left as vice president, Gerald Ford was appointed vice president.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then Nixon left office and Gerald Ford became president, becoming the only person who was never elected to the office.
Unelected president.
Yeah. At no point did he get elected for that job. So
and remember the story about when he almost got shot outside the St. Francis
Hotel? Squeaky Fromm, yeah.
No, yep. That was Sarah Jane Moore in San Francisco.
Sarah Jane Moore.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
And the guy, there's a great story about the guy who saved his life, who grabbed her hand, was he was a Vietnam veteran who was gay, but he had never been out, you know, so his family didn't know. And Harvey Milk knew that he was gay, and Harvey Milk wanted to out him so he could be like a hero, but mm-hmm. the guy didn't want to be outed. But Harvey Milk got a hold of Herb Cain, and they put it in the paper, and it kind of ruined his life with his family. They kind of disowned him.
Those were the days when if you were gay, they disowned you, which, you know, my feeling always was whenever I heard that was, what kind of a family are you? What kind of a father or mother are you if you will disown your child because of his sexuality?
The Bible says it's horrible, and that's why they do it, I guess.
Well,
actually, the Bible doesn't say anything about homosexuality.
It is an abomination in the eyes of the Lord. Yes, I'll have to agree with that.
That's funny. Jewish parents never kick their kids out when they say they're gay.
No, they just make them feel guilty for it for the rest of their lives.
I take that back. They don't only male homosexuality. Female, there's nothing against lesbianism in the Bible.
Oh, no. In fact, they have nothing against it. And not only that, they like to watch.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's just, what was it? Lenny Bruce used to have a routine he gave where he said, if a guy just accidentally touches another guy, all of a sudden he's gay. All right.
Yeah, that's true.
But a woman can be a lesbian. And everybody makes every excuse they can for her, like, oh, she's a real tomboy, you know, and that they will deny to the nth degree that this woman is a lesbian. Oh, no, she's just curious, you know. Women got a pass on that, but guys never did. When I was a kid, man, what did they say in the schoolyard when they wanted to say something nasty about you?
Yeah.
What are you, queer something?
Yes.
Which I got a lot, you know, because I didn't like playing.
I can see that.
I was metrosexual before there was such a thing, you know, because I didn't like to play sports. Okay. And my father used to take me to the ballet and the symphony. All right, because
guarantee
instill them in me culture. But I wasn't gay. But they, what, are you queer or something? You don't play baseball. You queer or something? So I used to like to tell all my gay friends later on, later years, was that I was gay before you were, and I wasn't even gay. But I knew what it was like, you know, and I knew what it was like for people to call you that, and that was like the worst thing they felt they could say about you. So, you know, whatever. Hello, Josh. How are you this evening?
Good. How are you?
Yeah, how's the wife doing?
Well, she's good.
Yeah. What now? What's going to happen? There's an operation she's going to have?
I think so, yeah. She had to have some kind of scan yesterday, and then she goes to meet with that orthopedic doctor Monday
now,
or something.
Now, what happened? She it was her hand or what, her knee or what?
That's her elbow and her, like, her forearm.
Okay. All right. All right. Well, those things are fairly easily taken care of.
Yeah. She had some other stuff, too, that was, you know, like, bruising and, like, you know, all, like, beat up and stuff, but those were, like, lasting injuries.
I mean, Marjorie, you know, was pushed to the concrete by a tourist in New York City, mm-hmm. and wound up having to have an operation on her knee. What is all that noise? Who's making all that noise? There's some kind of quacking around.
I think it's Kevin.
And you too. He's eating peanuts or something. Chomp.
No. But it was something metallic or something hitting against something.
You opened a can of peanuts?
Did you open a can of peanuts, Kevin?
Pistachios.
Yeah. There we go.
Yeah, but wait a minute. I know those pistachios, and they're not in a can, right? Right?
No, it was a bag.
In fact, hold it up. I bet it says Kirkland on it.
Yeah, it does, but I have them in a little cup here.
Oh, I see. That's what was making the noise.
Yeah, otherwise I'll eat the whole damn bag.
Oh, you know something? They're not that fattening or anything. You know,
Kirkland Jelly Bellies.
They're actually they're one of my go-to snacks if I wanted a low-carb snack.
Me too.
Yeah.
Jelly Bellies are a low-carb snack. My roommate got me because he knows I'm trying to lose weight, and I can't stop eating the damn thing.
Well, I've started going on a diet. I think I've lost a couple of pounds so far.
Really?
And I went and took a mile and a half walk today. So.
All right.
You know. I'm getting
I'll put this out of my reach for 5 minutes.
Well, no, here's what you can do. Here are snacks you can have. First of all, you have to ask everybody to keep referring to you as that tub of lard, okay? In other words, I hate it when people go and they say, somebody says, do I look fat to you? And they're this giant blob, right? And people go, oh, no, you're not. Well, all you're doing is killing this person.
When the scale says 400, that's a clue.
Yeah. What if you've got a... this is a true story. Stop me if you've heard this story before, and if enough of you have heard this story before, I'll stop. But I used to work, when I was working at WMCA, I started getting calls after my show at about 5 o'clock in the morning, because I was on overnight, from some woman who started talking to me in very sexy ways, and, you know, telling me all the things she wanted to do to me. And of course, I had time for that. I didn't want to run right home, and I listened to her. And every night she would call. Well, one morning, I had this friend of mine. And he was there with me, and she calls, and I said, "You got to hear this, right?" And I'm talking with her, and he's going, "Wow!" She said to me, "Why don't you come over and see me?" And he says, "Cover the phone." He says, "I dare you." Well, now you know.
Is this the Barbara Bush story?
And when somebody says, "I dare you," especially in New York, and I think it may have even been worse than that. It was, "I double dog dare you," which
double dare,
in that case, you got to go, right? So I went, okay, tell me where you are. She says, I'm at the McAlpin Hotel, room 604, something like that. Come on, see me. And I went, okay. She had this really sexy voice. And the things she was saying to me, I can't even repeat here when I can say anything I want to here. That's how sexy it was and how provocative it was. So I go over to the McAlpin Hotel, and I go up to room 604, and I knock on the door, and the door opens up, and there's this woman in the door who you can't see either jam of the door because she was so fat that you literally couldn't see her.
And the fat was she?
So fat, yeah. So then she says something to me, because I'm thinking of every way I can get out of this, all right? And she says something to me that killed me. She said, "You don't have to come in if you don't want to." I don't want to hurt somebody's feelings, right?
Yeah, how can you not? Yeah.
How can you not? She says, "You can come in if you want to." Well, somehow I managed to do the deed just to keep her happy. I figured, when's the last time anybody ever did this with her? I thought of that for all the years that I'd had good sex in my life, this was my way of giving back. Okay?
You were a horny old dog, weren't you?
No, it wasn't. I was a horny old dog. I didn't want to, but I just closed my eyes and I did. I don't even know if I actually entered her. It may have been a crease.
Okay.
It may have been
folded
a crease.
Her arm, that's right.
Yeah. It may have been a crease. I don't know, but I came like a
folded fucking.
I came really fast, which you usually do if you're not in a happy situation, right? And I said, "Well, thank you very much, and I'll call you soon. Bye-bye." And I leave and I go. And I go home. And my phone rings. And it's now about 7 o'clock in the morning, or 8 o'clock in the morning, and it's my friend. And he says, "What happened?" And I'm thinking to myself, this is the guy that got me into this. So I said to him, "You're not going to believe this, but I went up to her McAlpin Hotel, room 604, knocked on the door. When the door opened, she was the most gorgeous, sexy thing I have ever seen in my life." And he says, "Oh, really?" I said, did you have sex with her?" I said, "Yeah." "Oh, come on." You know, I said, "It was amazing. She did things to me I haven't had any other woman ever do to me." So he says, "Well, okay, good to hear it. And I'll talk to you later. I know what's going to happen."
Yep.
2 hours later, I get a call from this guy. "You goddamn son of a bitch." I said, "Oh, what? Why am I a goddamn son of a bitch?" He said, "You didn't tell me she was that fat and that ugly." And I said, "Well, what happened?" He said, "Well, I walked up to the door. The door opened. I saw this thing, right? And the first thing she says to me is, 'You don't have to come in if you don't want to.'" And I said, "What did you do?" He says, "What can you do when somebody says that?" Yeah. And all I can think is, this woman is getting laid 5 times a night using the "you don't have to come in if you don't want to" ploy. So that's my story. And I'm sticking
great.
To it. There's a little postscript to this story. This guy was such a pervert that he couldn't believe she was that fat. So he invited her out to his house in Queens just so he could somehow get her on a scale and see how much she actually weighed. And I asked him, "How much did she weigh?" He says, "I have no idea. The scale went to 300 and then it went some more. I don't know how much she weighed."
Shit. You know, his apartment is still tilted sideways.
Yes. But anyway, that's a true story. Absolutely true story.
Can I ask Vernon a question?
Wait a minute. John has a question here.
Oh, sorry.
I just wanted to say a little story. I had this really good friend of mine I worked with at the Warfield. She was an usher, mm-hmm. and she was very heavy, you know, real, real heavy. Mm-hmm. And but she was really nice, great person. Everybody liked her. She actually just passed away last year from COVID. Mm-hmm. But one time, you know, I'd go out with her and we'd party, but I never would, you know, I'd never had sex with her. Mm-hmm. No, I don't even know if she ever even wanted to, because she was like, I was like 15 years older than her. But anyway, mm-hmm. one time she pulls out a picture on her phone of her when she was like 20 years younger, and she was fucking gorgeous, just unbelievable. And I just looked at it and I just said, what do you say to someone like that, you know? I didn't want to say, fuck, what happened to you, you know? It was just like, oh, God. But I just said, dude, that's a nice picture.
Yeah. I can see him saying, you look the same.
Yeah. You have a question for Vernon, you say, Alan?
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. All the electronic equipment behind you, is that the stereo equipment?
No, let him know what it is. Give him an idea of what that is, Vernon. Wait a minute. You're
turn
muted.
Sound
for
on.
Some reason, your sound
UFOs.
Isn't on. Your sound isn't
audio.
On.
Audio.
Audio.
Check, 1, 2.
Well, his microphone is on, or at least his audio is
on. Maybe it's going through that equipment. I don't know.
But
maybe his sound is turned way down.
Ham radio equipment.
Yeah.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah, it's ham radio equipment. Yeah.
Okay.
While he's working his microphone.
I have some high
end. Hold on a second. We're trying to get Vernon here.
Sorry.
Can you find out what it is, Vernon?
He's working his D-104. Change your D-104.
It just might be the audio isn't going through, but the thing is sensing, Zoom is sensing that you have your audio open. Okay. Oh, boy. Well.
Do you want to laugh, Alex?
Do I
Since
want
my to... mother passed away, I lost 35 pounds.
Whoa.
Wow.
Yeah. Wow. I was eating out of aggression, I think.
Okay, how's it now?
Oh, now we're
there.
Good.
You
okay.
go.
Show him what kind of equipment that is. Go ahead, do it.
Well, this thing back here, believe it or not, is an old Army surplus receiver, an R390.
Mm-hmm.
It's worth about $1,000 right now on eBay.
Oh, wow.
This little piece of equipment here is my very first, when I was high school, my very first single sideband transmitter. And I've kept it all these years because it was a Heath kit when I first bought it secondhand from another guy.
Wow.
And I ended up going through it when I was in college and completely stripping and rebuilding the entire chassis.
Wow. Okay. Now, can you do the thing for him so he can hear what you do?
Let me see here. Maybe I can.
Mm-hmm.
Let me try something here. Mm-hmm. That little thing you usually hear is over on the other table.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Let me see here. It's probably not loud enough.
Morse code?
Yeah. He does Morse code.
Yep.
Yeah. In fact,
very good.
In fact, do I have that? No, I guess I don't have it here. Maybe I do.
Do it on the other table.
Mm. No, I don't. There we go.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
I used to have my camera and everything on the other table over there, but that computer died, so I had to move it over here. This is actually my operating position, and I've got a solid-state transceiver sitting in front of me.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Oh, Very cool.
When I was in high school, a friend of mine needed $100, and he had some what he called high-end stereo equipment. And I ended up with a receiver, a preamp, and something else, and they were all with tubes, and the name brand is Macintosh.
Right.
Oh, I remember those.
Of course.
Yeah, that was very, I didn't know at the time, but I bought it, and it worked, but I found out it's worth, you know, like
a
lot of money.
Macintosh amplifiers were tube amplifiers, and they were the best. If you wanted to buy the best amplifier back in the day, It was a Macintosh. In fact, I would imagine the ones
that are still valuable even today.
The ones that are still working are probably terrific, and there are people who swear by tube amplifiers.
Yeah. You know who I think likes that, Alex? Who? Phil. I think Phil has one of those Macintoshes. I could be wrong.
Really? Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. But people.
Yeah, but his is made by Apple.
I've heard somebody talking about high definition audio.
Yeah.
And high definition audio nowadays, you know, they usually talk about digital audio.
Yeah.
But I know some people who are real audio aficionados, and they say you can't beat analog audio for high definition.
Yeah, I've heard that a million times.
Well, there are some people who firmly believe, for instance, in vinyl.
Yeah.
As being much much better than digital. Because digital is not really the sound. It's just a representation of the sound in ones and zeros. Whereas what you got off a disc was an actual modulation and amplification. A lot of people will swear by vinyl. But the only problem with vinyl is that it can get worn out. And it can get scratches, and it can get a lot of other things. But if you've got the proper kind of turntable and the proper kind of needle that isn't going to impact it, because there are some that don't impact it, supposedly it sounds like you will never hear anywhere else.
Mm. Yeah, that's why vinyl never went away. When CDs first came out, they were saying that's the end of vinyl. You're never going to have vinyl again.
You can still go to stores and buy vinyl.
Yeah. I was in the mall with my sister, and there's like one of those kind of like they sell like old records, this and that, knickknacks. They had a whole section on vinyl, all like new stuff and old stuff reissued.
Yeah, and you can go to stores.
Anybody want some? I got 300 vinyl records.
I've got 719.
Well,
pay for the shipping. I'll ship them.
Charlie wins.
I got rid of and sold, before I came out here, close to 2,000 LPs. Well, I was in the broadcast business. I kept getting all these free records.
Came home with you, Alex. Would they say anything? Oh, no, you could just say, well, can you pick through the records of the new stuff you liked and just take it home?
What do you mean?
Like, say when you were in the 70s or something, when they had new records coming to this radio station, can you just go through the records and take what you want?
I didn't have to. They mailed them to me.
Oh, right to the house?
No, to the station.
The state.
Yeah.
So you got any new record you want? Well,
they had a list of all the disc jockeys on the radio station, and then each disc jockey would get like a package from like Atlantic Records or RCA or whatever every month. Yeah. That was their form of promotion, you know. But so I had about 2,000 albums. And I had somebody come in, and I think they bought the whole batch for about $4,000, except I didn't sell a certain bunch of them. And the bunch I didn't sell were comedy records. I still have those comedy LPs in storage. I probably should see what they would get, because they're pretty good. You know.
So I can make money on my Macintosh equipment?
I've had it since
high school.
If it's in good shape,
It's in good shape. It's packed. When I found out it was high end, I didn't have any use for it. I packed it up, but I found it a couple weeks ago, and I would imagine it would work.
You also have to get the tubes for it.
Yeah, well, but if it works, then I don't need more tubes.
No.
Getting tubes it used to be you can go down to the drugstore and test them and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Right.
My father used to work on our home TV.
You'd look at all the tubes and see which one didn't light up, and then you'd take it in.
Yeah, they had a test thing at the, you plugged the tube in and tested it, and then underneath you pulled out the tube. My father used to work on TVs, and he's like, hey, could you hand me a screwdriver one day? I'll never forget this. I hand him a screwdriver, and there on the picture tube, there's one big wire that goes in. That's where the high voltage goes into the picture tube. My father was touching the screwdriver and went to short out that little thing, and it shorted him out. I mean, he survived, but it was a jolt.
When TV first came out, the old TV sets were deadly.
Yeah.
Literally, this thing was
huge capacitors in there.
Yeah. Yeah. So, cool. Today, I mean, these things are,
nowadays, you can watch TV on your iPhone.
10 volt, right?
What?
10 volts.
What's 10 volt?
Voltage on all of that radio equipment.
No, 115 volt.
115 volts?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Household current is 115 volts AC.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Unless you get across the 220, then you get some serious jolt.
Yeah.
You can be dead.
Yeah.
Either one. More people are killed on 110 volts than they are on high voltage because they think it won't hurt them.
You know who called tonight and was listed here on the calls but never wound up being on the show was Brian Neary.
Yeah, he was in the chat room before.
Yeah, and then when I came on, he wasn't there, and he hasn't been there for the rest of the show.
Yeah, but I think Friday night's movie night for his
That's right. He does a movie night, yeah.
Well, I wonder why he tried to sign in to the show.
Well, he was just in a chat.
Maybe he was just listening to your...
No, he was on Zoom. He was ready in the waiting room on Zoom.
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, because he's going to Hawaii next week. So I wanted to wish him a happy, happy trip, you know.
Yeah.
So what do you think about the death of Prince Philip? I don't know if there's much to discuss. I mean, you know, 99 years old.
Wow, he lived a good life.
He lived a full, rich life. Yeah. Absolutely.
I mean,
I agree with you that the Queen probably won't last much longer because they were soulmates.
Yeah, they really were. Yes, Tony.
Yeah, I'll take, you know, another, you know, as I'm getting older, it's almost like I would sign on, Alex, and I'm not meaning it like it's your 80, but I would take a healthy 80 if I had my mind still, if I had to sign on.
Hmm.
Because as you get older, you know what I noticed? You have less tolerance. Like since my mom passed away, like some of her family, like my cheap uncle and them, I'm so glad I don't have to talk to them anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, I'm being honest. I can't take them.
Well, your level of tolerance does diminish a great deal.
I find it has, Alex.
I never asked you this, Kevin. How old are you now?
Who, me?
Yeah, 52. Yeah, you. You're
63.
Do you find as you're getting older, you have less patience with stuff than you did when you were younger?
Some things.
Yeah.
But some things I don't give a shit about anymore.
Yeah, that's how I feel.
Okay.
Like how many pistachios.
Name one thing you don't give a shit about.
Work.
Right. In other words, life's too short to worry about your job.
Yeah, because I don't have one anymore. Well, I did give a shit about it for about 2 years.
Yeah.
But then realized there's more important things to deal with.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Vernon.
What I found as I've gotten older is my tolerance for bullshit has decreased.
What about negative people? Like the people who just get on your nerves, it's like you just don't want to. That's
but negative people you can just avoid.
That's what I do now. I get that's some of my family members were always like negative. I was like, I'm only supposed to call them dog.
Deal with them. You can become the editor of your life in that respect. You know. Josh, how old are you now? I never ask you that. I figure you're in your 40s, right?
I'm 38.
Oh,
yeah, that's what I thought.
God, you look terrible. you're 38? Really?
Oh, yeah, I remember him being under 40.
You know what it is? He's an old soul. You know? I mean,
eyes roll.
Well, he knows about things that happened in the 1800s.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I don't know a person in their 30s who, for a good time, goes to, Civil War battle sites, which I think is a great thing you do, Josh. But usually people who are of your generation don't really care about that, you know. And you seem to have an absolute preoccupation with American history.
Yeah, I mean, that's, my educational background and everything was in, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what we do. We go to a lot of other places, too. I mean, we, like I said before, we visit everywhere that the Park Service runs, all the national historic sites, national parks. So, I mean, all the outside, the wildlife, scenic areas, all that other kind of stuff,
too. Well, you have the pass, too, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, we do all those too. You know, most of our travels revolve around that. But, I mean, I like it because it takes you all over the country. I mean, a lot of that stuff, it's not in large cities and all that. So, you know, we see a lot of, you know, I don't want to say like real America or whatever, but not just large cities. I mean, we go through a lot of really small places and, you know, that you've not really heard of or know anything about, and little towns all throughout the southern U.S. and out west, you know, little tiny places out west and wide open areas, you know, scenic stuff out west, all that kind of stuff. So we do that too, but.
Well, there are national parks. That I watched a documentary on the creation of the national parks, the thing Ken Burns did about
the national parks. Yeah, I've seen it.
And it started bringing up the national parks and so on. And there were some I never ever heard of.
Yeah, there's quite a few.
Yeah.
There's 61 now, I think, maybe.
61? Yeah.
I think so.
Yeah. Something and then like there, that.
61, 62.
And then there's another thing that aren't national parks, but there's something else. They're like historic sites or whatever.
Yeah, they have 4 or 5 designations. They have national parks. Mm-hmm. You know, which are the well-known, the large national, you know, more like outside, like wildlife or scenic areas, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Geological, whatever. But they also have national historic sites.
Mm-hmm.
They have national monuments. They have national battlefields, national military parks. And there might be one other designation that I'm missing.
State.
No, I can't remember.
State parks.
You know, but...
Well, the state parks is in the state system, but that's a whole
different
system.
Right, federal. So, I mean, like, only Congress can designate a national park. Congress must designate a national park and fund it. But by executive order, the president can designate anything other than a national park, like a national monument.
Well, we have, national seashores?
Yeah, they do. Yeah. They do have national seashores, like Cape Cod, I think, has one.
Yeah.
Cape Hatteras or something in North Carolina has one. I think it's out west.
Dude. I've been there. That's beautiful.
Yes, Alan.
Oh, I'll wait till Josh is done. I'm sorry.
He was.
So, the side chat things. We're up to 46 people. They're finding it interesting. My favorite person, Jessica Bowling Ball, she told me to shut up. And then you have a fan too, Matt Crash, if you can see it, Josh. He says, 38 ? What the fuck? That dude looks so old. What is with these people? They don't have a life?
Well, I can do something. For instance, we have Matt Crash. He says, vinyl is alive and well with my millennial generation. Yeah. Fuck your millennial generation.
Oh, shit.
Shut up, Alan, and let Alex tell the story. Let me see here. I'm trying to find somebody who's been particularly nasty. Somebody who's...
I mean, this guy, Matt Crash, you know? I mean, you know, Josh tells how old
okay,
he is.
Okay, Matt Crash has been saying a lot of nasty things, okay?
Time to get rid of him. I'm gonna complain to
YouTube. He's been there for years.
Really?
He has been there for years? I've never noticed him.
He's really that fat woman in the hotel.
Probably. And by the way, Matt, if you want to call this program, you don't have to come in if you don't want to.
I don't know how many of the parks that we've been to of the 61. I don't know. We've been to quite a few, but we've also been to a lot of the other sites too. I mean, like the Park Service makes like this passport book. You know, they make a little tiny one, but then they also make a larger one that has every site they have. You know, all 50 states and the territories and all that. So that, you know, you have all of them and, you know, each one you go to, they'll stamp it and say you were there. And I don't really care about that. My wife thinks it's the greatest fucking thing that ever happened. Yeah. You know, she'd drive clear across the country and they could fucking stamp a book and,
we have some national parks up in Alaska, right?
Yeah, I think there's 5 or 6,
You should really try to, have you gotten up there at all?
Well, no, we haven't made it to Alaska, no. I'll have to... I have to, I mean, the best way to go to Alaska is in your own RV, really, which I've looked into quite a lot. And we've talked, I've talked to Kevin about that on Saturday before, but I mean, you gotta have a lot of time. So we would have to be, you know, I'll retire from what I'm doing pretty early. So, you know, we'll have to wait a few more years for that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, we've been to a lot of the larger ones out west, you know, the last couple of years. I mean, I've been to some of the nicest places. I mean, you know, the United States has got scenic stuff, man. I mean, yeah. I've been to Yellowstone and, you know, Grand Teton and all the parks in South Dakota, a bunch of them in Utah.
Well, you know, Arizona. What happened was I always, when I wanted to go somewhere to see a great area or whatever, I always went to Europe. You know, I want to see the Alps and things like that. And you go, oh, it's wonderful, it's marvelous. Well, a couple of years ago when I came back to New York City in the year 2004, I guess it was, Shecky flew out, and then we got in a car, and I started driving out to New York because I wanted to, you know, bring my stuff with me. And we traveled across the United States. And I was amazed how beautiful this country is.
Yeah, it's great. I mean,
that if you take a vacation sometime, you should take a vacation in the United States, you know, and see.
Yeah, I mean, that's why we don't fly anywhere that we go. I mean, that's why we always drive, because that's what I'm saying. Is, I mean, driven all the way across Wyoming, north and south and east and west. You know, a couple times on two-lane roads, and I mean, cattle areas, and I mean, just seeing great stuff. I mean,
saw that very few people see. They don't do it. Is the North Rim of the Grand Canyon?
Yeah, I went this summer, right?
Which is amazing. Wow. Just
amazing.
There
were like 50 people there.
I know, because they all go to the South Rim,
right? And we went to the South Rim too, and then we drove all the way around to go to the North Rim, and you had to take this really long way around because you couldn't exit out of the east entrance because it exits onto an Indian reservation and they had it closed. You couldn't cut through it.
Right.
And they wouldn't even let you drive through. They had closed the reservation. So we had to go all the way back to Flagstaff and back up. It was nice because we drove through the Vermilion Cliffs National Monument. So another national monument. And the Vermilion Cliffs National Monument, you know, is those really tall red, you know, cliff rocks that you see in a lot of Western movies and all that.
Right.
And, you know, there's a lot of BLM, Bureau of Land Management land out there and roads you can go off on and camp out there for free and stuff if you want. I mean, we didn't do that, but we drove through a bunch of scenic overlooks. We crossed the Colorado River at one point in a canyon. It's only about 50 yards wide.
Did you see Monument Valley?
No, we did not go to Monument Valley this year.
Yeah. Yeah, but
when we left the North Rim, we could have went to Monument Valley if we were going to go to the other parks in Utah on the eastern side, but we went up to Zion and Bryce Canyon.
Well, because Shecky and I are movie fans, we had to see. We had to go to Monument Valley.
I mean, I haven't been there yet.
Yeah.
That's nice. Let me
ask Steve, Trucker Steve, something. You know, you drive more than any of us drive now. I'm sure Kevin in his time logged quite a few miles because of the truck. But with you, you log a lot of miles with the truck. Are there certain areas that your truck goes that you go, oh, thank God I'm here. It's so wonderful here.
Yeah, I like the Southwest. I like running 40.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a big fan of Wyoming.
I didn't like Wyoming either.
Wyoming is just too bloody windy.
Also, when I traveled across the United States, it was the only place I got a ticket. There was a speed trap. They know that people go through this area, and it's like a speed trap, and they just nail you. You know. John Larkin.
A couple of years ago, I drove to Wyoming to go to see the solar eclipse,
mm-hmm.
because I guess Casper, Wyoming was one of the cities that it was going to go through.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if anybody saw it in the full, you know, 100% thing, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It was fucking amazing. People were crying. It was so amazing, you know.
Yeah.
When the the sun goes and you just see a big, huge diamond circle in the sky and everything's all dark. It's fucking breathtaking.
Now, on the other hand, Tony's never been out of Queens. So, where have you been, Tony? Have you gone places? Seen things?
Yeah, actually, yeah. Well, my brother took me to San Francisco a few years ago. Remember, I was in your old hunting grounds.
Mm-hmm.
I went to San Fran. I went to, as a kid, we used to drive down to Florida a lot. I kind of used to get car sick, though. My mother used to say I used to throw up. I threw up on her in like North Carolina, I think, or something.
Yeah, but the problem with going to Florida is that's where Matt Gaetz is. So you don't really want to be near there.
I remember, and what else did we go? I went to Canada once. I remember that was in the late 70s. It was usually Florida with Disneyland. I always remember as a kid, we always used to rent a car and drive down there. We liked it.
My father
didn't want to stop there.
By the way, who is the guy, Family Guy, who is the pervert? The character that's the pervert. You know who I'm talking about?
His friend. Isn't it the pilot?
Yeah, what's his name?
Quagmire?
Quagmire. Quagmire.
Yes, yeah. I just watched
it. Ever notice that Matt Gaetz looks like Quagmire?
I gotta look at him. Does he?
He really does.
Tony is lucky. Tony is probably 40 years old, too old for Matt Gaetz.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm 51.
Well, yes, Jeff.
Like 10-year-old.
Yes, the only state that I haven't gone to, if I'm correct, is North Dakota.
Why go there?
Yeah.
No good.
Why go there? In fact, stay out of South Dakota. To begin with, those two, what's his name? Bill Maher always brings this up, and he's absolutely right. Is that why is there a North and a South Dakota? Why don't they just make it the Dakota and just have two senators from that area? Right? But they get two senators. They get as many senators as California gets, as New York gets, or whatever. And because they've divided into two states, they get four senators to basically represent the same population.
Yeah.
You know?
And that's why the Republicans are fighting D.C. statehood, because then D.C. would have two more senators.
Oh, you're right.
And they'd be Democrats.
Right. I think D.C. should have statehood.
Absolutely.
You know?
And Puerto Rico.
I think, absolutely. You know, I mean, I just think that, Puerto Rico, obviously, you know. But you know something? You talk to people from Puerto Rico, and they don't necessarily want to become a state.
Yeah.
There's some kind of reason they don't want to, and I can't remember now. They get to vote, right?
No, they don't get to vote for president.
They don't get to vote for president?
No.
Oh. Yeah.
They don't get a vote in the Senate or the House.
But they get to pay taxes.
They pay income taxes.
Right.
Don't they get some kind of a representative that doesn't get the vote?
Can't vote, yeah, but they get a...
sort of a representative of some sort.
Like that lady D.C. has one representative, but she does not vote.
Yeah.
Oh, D.C. does have one representative, but you can't vote? I didn't know that.
Right.
Nope. I didn't know that.
Virgin Islands also has one representative, but they don't vote.
The lady that was one of the impeachment prosecutors was from the Virgin Islands.
Well, the District of Columbia is a fairly formidable size. It's not huge. But those people don't have any representation. And it's terrible. But they do get to vote in the national presidential races and so on. Yes, Alan.
Puerto Rico gets to vote in the primary, but not the main election.
Same thing with Washington, D.C.
Right.
They do not vote in a general election on November 3rd. Or
but they can vote in a primary?
They vote in the primary, yeah.
Right.
That's weird.
I don't know why.
Who do they vote for? Somebody from Maryland or what?
I don't know.
No, but the president represents them too, so they should get the vote for president. Yeah.
Wow.
Trump didn't think so.
That's amazing. You know, little things I don't know. There's a lot I don't know, actually, to be honest with you. But
there's little things we can all learn every day.
Yeah. Yes, Vernon.
I heard you all talking about Rachel Maddow's book, and I've read that. It's called Bagman. Mm-hmm. And it was about the Spiro Agnew scandal.
Oh, really?
And what a lot of people don't understand is it was back during that time that the Office of Legal Counsel came up with that opinion that said that a sitting president could not be indicted. It was because of the Spiro Agnew scandal.
But a sitting vice president?
No, but I'm saying a sitting vice president. They were afraid that Spiro Agnew was going to become president because they knew that it's a possibility Nixon was going to resign, and they knew what a scumbag Agnew was, but they wouldn't be able to go after him. That's why they put so much pressure on him to resign before Nixon did.
Wow. Hmm. Wow. But you say it was at that time they came up with this, you can't indict a sitting president?
The Justice Department came up with that opinion. Of course, now with Merrick Garland in there, you know, they could very well, you know, change that policy. It's a policy in the Justice Department is what it is.
Well, I mean, a form of indictment is impeachment. I mean, that is an indictment.
That's a political indictment. Talking about criminal indictments, like taking money while you're in office.
Well, like, for instance, Donald Trump, conceivably, could he have taken out a gun, shot somebody to death, and then not be put on trial for it?
Until he was out of office. That's correct.
Oh, then they could charge him with it.
After he's out of office, he
could be charged. Okay. Is there a statute of limitations on murder? Yes.
Well, not on murder, no.
Oh, okay.
He went to the Supreme Court, and he lost it, though. So he can't. He couldn't do it because he lost it in the Supreme Court.
What about
Court,
all the people he killed during COVID?
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Well, that's mass murder. Yeah.
He's being sued right now for the inciting the insurrection.
You know what I get? I'm just sorry that the Matt Gaetz thing has happened. Because what happens because of Matt Gaetz is, every time they want to show a picture of Matt Gaetz, they show him with Trump. And I just would like him to just go away.
Trump's kind of old for him, isn't he?
Go away. Huh?
Trump's kind of old for him, isn't he?
Well, you've heard the Republicans are down in Florida at his Doral property for some kind of convention, you know, a meet and greet or something.
Oh, wonderful.
Women for Trump or something like that.
Well, yeah, and Trump was getting ready to sue the Republican Congressional Committee for using his name and likeness without his permission. So they all went over to have dinner with him at Mar-a-Lago to kind of smooth things over. Gee.
And is he going to send out another one of those letters getting money from people pre-checked so that it's recurring?
Recurring every week?
Mm-hmm. Oh, man, oh, man. Oh, well, you know. Anyway, let's hit the theme song here. Hey, thank you so much, Alan, for being here tonight. Trucker Steve, always good to have you here. The lovely and attractive Charlie Wallace, thank you. We always appreciate you. Jeff, good having you here. You were rather chatty tonight.
Oh.
You know? And Josh Wheeler, of course. We love having you here because the intelligence that comes with it is not to be questioned. John Larkin, thank you. Thank you, Kevin, my old pal. And Vernon Nunn, always great to see you here. Finally, of course, Tony. Thank you, Tony. That's it. Hey, everybody, why don't you give a big wave goodbye, and I'll give a wave goodbye back at you, okay? There they go, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, there we go. Oh, here. My hand was off a bit there. Okay. I guess I should have. I was doing this. Why was I doing that? That's ridiculous. Anyway, Jack Bishop is next over most of this same GabNet. He'll be here. He's going to be using Skype as the method of calling. So please call him. He'll be on Skype at GabNet Live. That's the address you call, GabNet Live. I'm Alex Bennett. We're back here again on Monday at 4 o'clock for a little pop-up show that we like to do. And then we'll be back here with the Ramble again come next Tuesday, okay, at 10:30. Same time, same station in life. In the meantime, as always, if you see her, tell her I love her. And by the way, everybody, it's we're too close to the finish line. Wear a mask and be safe out there. Good night, everybody.